I wanted to bring you a Christmas mystery, so I thought of this infamous and emotional roller coaster of a case. I've never heard any other case like this. On the night before Christmas in 1945, the Sodder family at US Highway 21 in Fayetteville, West Virginia, went to bed excited about Christmas morning. There was a little snow on the ground, and in just a few hours, Christmas would be here. But instead of happiness, the family woke up to a nightmare that would literally never end. George and Jennie Sodder immigrated from Italy. They went on to have 10 children, and their family was very respected in their small town. On Christmas Eve, their oldest daughter, Marion, had bought her siblings gifts that they begged to stay up and play with. And because it was Christmas, their mother told them that they could, as long as they fed the chickens and the cows, they made sure to clean up, they closed the curtains, and they turned off the lights. And as they played, they listened to the radio keeping track of Santa's location. The parents went to bed at 10:30, and around midnight, Marion fell asleep on the couch. Their oldest son, Joseph, was away in the army. Around 12:30 a.m., the phone rang, and a woman on the other end was asking for someone that didn't live there. In the background, Jennie could hear the sound of clinking glasses like a party. The woman said that she had the wrong number, but Mrs. Sodder could hear people laughing, so she thought that it may have been a prank. This is when she noticed the curtains weren't closed and that the lights were still on. She saw Marion asleep on the couch, and she assumed that the others were upstairs asleep in the attic and that they had just forgotten to turn off the lights. The front door was also unlocked. Her children were usually good about turning the lights off and locking up, so she felt a little uneasy, but it was late, so she decided to go back to bed. At 1 a.m., she woke up to the sound of something hitting the roof with a loud bang and then a rolling sound. But again, she just didn't think much of it, and she tried to go back to sleep. A little after 1 a.m. on Christmas morning, Jennie smelled smoke, and when she got up, she saw fire in her husband George's office. She yelled to him, and he ran outside to get some water from the well, but it was frozen. Her daughter Marion was now awake, so she carried her little sister Sylvia outside to safety. By now, the fire had spread throughout all of the downstairs rooms, the living room and the dining room, the kitchen, George's office, and their bedroom. George couldn't see because of the smoke and the fire, so he went by what he already knew. He knew that 2-year-old Sylvia was outside with Marion, and that their two sons, John and George Jr., had gotten out, singeing their hair on the way. George was frantic, and he rushed back into the burning house, and he found that their only staircase was completely engulfed in flames. He assumed that Maurice, Martha, Louis, and Betty were still upstairs, so he ran outside planning to use his ladder to get them out through the upstairs windows. Unfortunately and strangely, the ladder that he always propped up against the house was missing. Days later, he found it tossed over a hill, so he tried to save them by breaking a window, which caused him to slice some skin from his arm. So Marion then runs to the neighbors to call the fire department, which was about 2.5 miles away, but she wasn't able to reach anyone because it was Christmas Eve. A man that drove past their house stopped at a nearby bar to call the fire department, but they didn't receive an answer either. He then decided to drive further into town, and he spoke with Fire Chief Morris, who, when told about the fire, said, "We know." The fire chief said he didn't know how to drive the fire truck, which I don't understand, and he also said that he had to wait on his men. He said they were low on manpower due to Christmas, and they used a phone tree, so whenever a call came in, an operator would take that call and wake up a firefighter who would then have to call the next one by one. The fire department didn't get to the Sodder's home until about 8 a.m., 7 hours later. By then, all that was left of the house was a smoking pile of ash. George and Jennie assumed that 5 of their children were dead, but one of the firefighters was Jennie's brother, and he told her they didn't find any remains, which was very strange. The next day, an investigation supposedly found that there was no foul play involved, and the cause of the fire was faulty wiring. The fire chief said that the fire was so hot that it cremated the bodies, including the bones. But typically, when bodies are burned, the bones are usually left behind, and there weren't any reports of the smell of burning flesh before or after the fire. The chief also told George and Jennie that their search was hopeless. What was this man hiding? Maurice, Martha, Louis, Jennie, and Betty were officially declared dead on December the 30th, 1945. But were they really dead? So what caused the fire? The fire was blamed on faulty wiring, but the wiring had been recently installed, and during the fire, the lights stayed on. The wiring was fine. It was discovered that the telephone lines around the house had been cut 14 feet off the ground and 2 feet from the nearest utility pole. Neighbors tipped the police to a man they saw stealing an automotive block and tackle at the scene of the fire. He pled guilty to the theft but denied any role in the fire. He admitted to cutting the telephone wire, saying that he mistaken it for the power line. Why he wanted to cut off their power is still a mystery. A witness that passed the Sodder house the night of the fire reported seeing balls of fire thrown onto their roof. About 2 months before the fire, a traveling life insurance salesman tried to sell George a life insurance policy. When George declined, the salesman told him his house would go up in smoke and your children were going to be destroyed. He also told him that he was going to pay for the dirty remarks that he'd made about Mussolini, the former prime minister of Italy and the founder of fascism. In Fayetteville's Italian immigrant community, George's disdain of Mussolini wasn't a secret, but he didn't take the salesman's threat seriously. The only thing left of the Sodder's home was the basement. George used a bulldozer to cover it up, and the family put up 5 memorial markers, a makeshift cemetery for the children. The family wanted to know why there were no remains in the ashes. As I said earlier, Chief Moore said that the fire had cremated the bodies, but a crematorium worker told Jennie that bones can remain intact after bodies are burnt at 2,000 degrees for 2 hours and that bones of significant size would often remain. Their house burned for 30 to 45 minutes. The National Funeral Directors Association confirmed that the optimum temperature for cremation is 1,400 to 1,800 degrees. Even parts of their appliances, some fabric, and some other items that would have burned up quicker than the human bones were also found at the scene. The fire actually burned at a lower temperature than standard funeral home cremations. 3 months after the fire, Jennie read about a similar fire that broke out around the same time where the remains of a family of 7 were found at the scene. That fire lasted the same amount of time as the Sodders. They took this information to the local authorities, but they were brushed off. The family knew if they wanted answers, they'd have to find them themselves. So George had the dirt removed that he used to cover up the basement and had another search conducted. They sent a letter to the FBI and received a reply from J. Edgar Hoover. He told them that he would like to help, but that it was more of a local matter. His agents agreed to help if they could get permission from the local authorities. Not surprisingly, the Fayetteville police and the fire department turned down the offer. That's when George and Jennie called a private investigator named C.C. Tinsley. He found out that the insurance salesman who threatened George and said their house was going up in smoke was also a member of the coroner's jury that deemed the fire accidental. That's an interesting connection. Earlier, the fire chief told the parents that we searched with a fine-tooth comb and we couldn't find a thing, but it was rumored that the chief actually told people that he did find some organ matter, which is something that he never reported to the coroner or to anyone else. C.C. Tinsley, the investigator, also discovered that the fire chief had been telling people that he found a heart at the site and that he hid it in a box and buried it where the house used to be. Tinsley persuaded the fire chief to show him the spot, so they dug up the box and they took it straight to a local funeral director, and he concluded that it was decayed beef liver. The box hadn't even been in the fire. The chief just buried the beef liver, hoping that the family would be satisfied by finding some remains and that they would stop the investigation. Were the Sodder children really kidnapped and the fire was a way to cover it up? There is evidence to support this theory. Jennie believed that maybe the children were kidnapped by someone they knew and that the person burst into the front door that was unlocked, told them about the fire, and offered to take them somewhere safe. She believes that if the kidnappers were strangers, that the children would have screamed, alerting them to the fact. Sightings began immediately after the fire. The Sodder children were reportedly seen in a car that was driving by watching the fire. A woman that owned a truck stop about 50 miles away said she saw the children the morning after the fire and that she had served them breakfast. At a hotel in Charleston, a woman saw the children's photos in a newspaper and said that she had seen 4 of them a week after the fire. She said they were with 2 couples who spoke Italian, and she tried to talk to the children in a kind manner, but the men refused to let her talk to them. One day, a letter arrived from a woman in St. Louis that said that Martha was in a convent there. Another tip came from Texas. A bar patron claimed to have overheard an incriminating conversation about a Christmas Eve fire in West Virginia that took place many years ago. Someone else in Florida claimed the children were staying with a distant relative of Jennie's. George traveled the country to investigate each and every single one of these leads, but he always came back without any answers. He saw a photograph in the newspaper of some children in New York, and he was convinced that one of them was his daughter Betty. So he drove to Manhattan looking for her, but her parents refused to speak to him. Over the next few years, tips and rumors continued to come in, including mafia gunmen and orphanages that stole children and sold them to couples. In 1952, George and Jennie put up a billboard along Route 16, and they passed out flyers offering a $5,000 reward for any information that led to the recovery of their children. In 1968, more than 20 years after the fire, Jennie went to get the mail and found an envelope addressed to her. It was postmarked in Kentucky, but it had no return address. Inside was a photo of a man in his mid-20s. He resembled Lewis, one of their missing sons. On the back of the picture was a weird message. The Sodders were worried that if they published the letter or the name of the town on the postmark, they might bring harm to their son. Instead, they sent another private investigator to Kentucky to see what he could find, but that detective was never heard from again. A year later, in 1968, George died, never knowing the truth about his children. Jennie had a fence put up around her property and began adding rooms to her home like she was building layers between her and the outside. Kind of makes me think of Sarah Winchester and the Winchester Mansion. After the fire, until the day she died in 1989, she only wore black. The billboard also came down after she died. Sylvia was the youngest and the last surviving Sodder child, and she didn't believe her siblings died in the fire. She said that her very first memories were of that night in 1945 when she was 2 years old. She would never forget the sight of her father bleeding or the terrible screams. She passed away in April 2021, and today there aren't any traces of the Sodder house, and the case remains open and unsolved. What do you think happened?